Harper Audio presents The Orchardist by Amanda Coplin, performed by Mark Bramhall. To my family, and in memory of my grandfather, Duane Eugene Sanders, 1936 to 1994. The roses you gave me kept me awake with the sound of their petals falling. Jack Gilbert. Part 1. His face was as pitted as the moon. He was tall, broad-shouldered, and thick without being stocky, though one could see how he would pass into stockiness. He had already taken on the barrel-chested sturdiness of an old man. His ears were elephantine, a feature most commented on when he was younger, when the ears stuck out from his head. But now they had darkened like the rest of his sun-exposed flesh, and lay against his skull more than at any other time in his life, and were tough, the flesh granular like the rind of some fruit. He was clean-shaven, large-pored. His skin was oily. In some lights his flesh was gray, others tallow, others red. His lips were the same color as his face, had given way to the overall visage, had begun to disappear. His nose was large, bulbous. His eyes were cornflower blue. His eyelashes, nothing to speak of now, but when he was young they were thick black, and his cheeks bloomed, and his lips were as pure and sculpted as a cherub's. These things together made the women compulsively kiss him, lean down on their way to do other chores, collapse him to their breasts. All his mother's sisters he could no longer remember from Arkansas, who were but shadows of shadows now in his consciousness. "Oh, my lovely," they would say. "Oh, my sweet lamb." His arms were sun-darkened and flecked with old scars. He combed his hair over his head, a dark, sparse wing kept in place with pine-scented pomade. He regarded the world, objects right in front of his face, as if from a great distance, for when he moved on the earth, he also moved in other realms, in certain seasons, in certain shades. Memories alighted on him like sharp-taloned birds, a head turning in the foliage, lantern light flaring in a room. And there were other constant preoccupations he likewise half acknowledged, in which his attention was nevertheless steeped at all times, present and past projects in the orchard, desires he had had as a young man, worries, fears of which he remembered only the husks, trees he had hoped to plant, experiments with grafting and irrigation, jam recipes, cellar temperatures, chemical combinations for poisoning or at least discouraging a range of pests, deer and rabbits and rodents and grubs, a universe of insects, how to draw bees. Important was the weather and patterns of certain years, the likelihood of repetition, meteorologically speaking, what that would mean for the landscape, the wisdom of the almanacs, the words of other men, other orchardists, the unimportant but mostly the important words. He thought of where he would go hunting next fall, considered constantly the state of his land, his property, his buildings, his animal. And mostly he thought of the weather that week, the temperature, and existence of or potential for rainfall, recent calamities and how he was responding to them, the position of the season, his position in the rigid scaffolding of chores, what he would have to do that day, that afternoon and evening, how he would prepare for the next morning's work, when were the men coming, and would he be ready for them? But he would be ready for them. He always was. He was nothing if not prepared. He considered those times in life when he had uttered words to a person, Caroline Middy, or Clee, or his mother, or a stranger who had long forgotten him. He wished he had never uttered, or had uttered differently, or he thought of the times he remained silent when he should have spoken as little as a single word. He tried to recollect every word he had ever spoken to his sister, tried to detect his own meanness or thoughtlessness, his own insensitivity to certain inflections she might have employed. How long ago it was now. At times he fretted about forgetting her, though in fact, he did not like to admit this, he had already forgotten much. Now, at his back, the shrouded bushels of apples and apricots rustled in the wagon bed, the wagon creaking forward beneath the weight, the old, old, familiar rhythm in accordance with these leagues of thought. Dazzled and suspended by the sun. The mountains, cold at his back. It was June. The road was already dusty, his frame slightly hunkered down, the floppy calfskin hat shielding his brow, under which was a scowl holding no animosity. The large hands, swollen knuckles, loosely holding the reins. From the wheat fields he entered the town and drew down the main street. Quiet. It was Sunday. The nearer church, he thought, the Methodist, was on the other side of town, had yet to release its congregation. He hitched up outside the feed and supply store, watered the mule. While he was setting up the fruit stand, tugging forward each burlap-covered bushel in the back of the wagon and unveiling them and unloading them, a woman rounded the corner and gained the platform, approached him. Half her face was mottled and pink, as if burned, her mouth an angry pucker. She held defensively to her breast a burlap sack and bent and inspected the up-tilted bushel of Arkansas blacks. She reached for an apple, but did not touch it, glanced dubiously at a bushel of paler apples he presently uncovered. "What are those?" He glanced down. "Greenings. Rhode Island greenings." When he spoke, his voice was low and sounded unused. He cleared his throat. The woman waited, considered the apples. "All right, I'll take a few of those." From the folds of her skirt, she brought out a dull green change purse. "How much?" He told her. She pinched out the correct change and handed it to him. As he filled the sack with fruit, the woman turned and gazed behind her, said, "Look what the cat drug in. Those two looking over here like that. You aren't careful, they'll come rob you. Hooligan looking." She sniffed. After a moment, he looked where she nodded. Down the street, under the awning of the hardware store, two girls, raggedy, smudge-faced, stood conspiratorially, half-turned toward each other. When they saw Talmage and the woman observing them, they turned their backs to them. He handed the burlap sack to the woman, the bottom heavy and misshapen with fruit. The woman hesitated, still looking at the girls, then turned and nodded shortly to him, stepped off the platform, moved down the street. From the wagon, he retrieved his wooden folding chair and sat down next to the bushels. Wind gusted and threw sand onto the platform, and then it was quiet. Rain was coming, maybe that evening or early the next day. The girls moved, stood now with their shoulders pressed together, looking into the window of the dry goods store. A gust of wind blew their dresses flat against their calves, but they remained motionless. He pulled his cap low. What did two girls mean to him? He dozed. Woke to someone addressing him.
"That you, Talmage? Those girls just robbed you."
He righted his cap. A slack-mouthed boy stood gaping at him.
"I saw them do it," said the boy. "I watched them do it. You give me a nickel, I'll run them down and get your apples back for you."
The girls had gotten farther than Talmage would have expected. They made a grunting sound between them in their effort at speed. Apples dropped from their swooped-up dresses, and they crouched or bent awkwardly to retrieve them. The awkwardness was due, he saw, to their grotesquely swollen bellies. He had not realized before that they were pregnant. The nearer one, smaller, pouting, her hair a great hive around her face, looked over her shoulder and cried out, let go the hem of her dress, lurched forward through the heavy thud of apples. The other girl swung her head around. She was taller, had black eyes, the hard startle of a hawk. Her hair in a thick braid over her shoulder. She grabbed the other girl's wrist and yanked her along, and they went down the empty road like that, panting, one crying, at a hobble trot. He stopped and watched them go. The boy at his side looked wildly back and forth between Talmage and the ragged duo.
I can get them! I can catch them, Talmage! He said,
wildly, back and forth.
Talmage!
The boy repeated. Talmage watched the girls retreat. He and his mother and sister had come into the valley in the summer of 1857, when he was 9 years old. They had come from the north-central portion of the Oregon Territory, where his father had worked the silver mines. When the mines collapsed, their mother did not even wait for the body of their father to be dredged up with the rest, but gathered their few belongings and set off with Talmage and his sister at once. They traveled north, and then west, west, and then north. They walked, mostly, and rode in wagons when they came along. They crossed the Wallawas and the Blue Mountains, and then came across great baked plains, what looked to be a desert. And then when they reached the Columbia, they took a steamboat upriver to its confluence with another river, where the steamboat did not go farther. They would have to walk, said the steamboat operator, uncertain. If they were thinking of going across the mountain pass to the coast, they would have to find someone, a trapper, an Indian, to guide them. And still, Talmage's mother was undeterred. From the confluence of the river, they walked 4 days toward mountains that did not seem to get any closer. The elevation climbed. The Cascades rose before them like gods. It was May. It snowed. Talmage's sister, Elspeth, who was a year younger than him, was cold. She was hungry. Talmage rubbed her hands in his own and told her stories of the food they would eat when they set up house. Cornbread and bacon gravy, turnip greens, stewed apples. Their mother said nothing to these stories. Why did she lead them north and then west, west and then north, as if drawing toward a destination already envisioned? They had heard that many, many miles away, but not so many as before they started, on the other side of the mountains was the ocean. Constant rain. Greenness. Maybe that's where they were going, thought Talmage. Sometimes, but how could he think this? How could a child think this of his mother? He thought she was leading them to their deaths. Their mother was considered odd by the other women at the mining camp. He knew this. He knew how they talked about her. But there was nothing really wrong with her, he thought, forgetting the judgment of a moment before. It was just that she wanted different things than those women did. That was what set them and his mother apart. Where some women wanted mere privacy, she yearned for complete solitude that verged on the violent. Solitude that forced you constantly back upon yourself, even when you did not want it anymore. But she wanted it nonetheless. From the time she was a small girl, she wanted to be alone. The sound of other people's voices grated on her, to travel to town, to interact with others who were not Talmage or Talmage's father or sister, was torture to her. It subtracted days from her life. And so they walked, to find a place that would absorb and annihilate her, a place to be her home and the home for her children, a place to show her children, and you belong to the earth. And the earth is hard. They climbed through cold, embittered forests and sought respite in bright meadows thick with wildflowers and insect thrumming. Maybe, thought Talmage, they had already died and this was heaven. It was easy at moments to believe. They came to a mining camp where five men sat inside an open hut, shivering, malnourished, warming their hands around a fire. It was lightly raining outside. When Talmage and his mother and sister came and stood before them, the men looked at them as if they were...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.